Welcome to the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast, the official podcast of the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. We are talking hunting, fishing, and conservation with engaging guests and in-depth discussions with game and fish staff. It's Arkansas Wildlife, the podcast for all things outdoors in the natural state.
Welcome to the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast. I'm Trey Reid, Assistant Chief of Communications at the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, along with Austin Booth, our director here at Game and Fish. Austin, what's up?
Good morning.
And we are very pleased today to invite into our Arkansas Wildlife Podcast an Arkansan that many folks will know, number 53 for the Razorbacks, the linebacker. He's the host of Morning Mayhem on 103.7 The Buzz, as well as the founder of numerous trophies and awards in college football, including the Broyles Award, and a great ambassador for the natural state in college football circles across the nation. It is the one and only David Bazzel. David, welcome aboard.
Good to be here, Trey. Good to be here, Austin. And yeah, listen, I get to watch you in action now. Usually I'm interviewing you Wednesday on The Buzz, which you do a great job, very popular with our listeners.
Well, thanks for allowing us to come on and talk about the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. And it's pretty cool because I think the demographic for Morning Mayhem and a lot of the Buzz shows aligns very closely with our constituency at Game and Fish. And no doubt when we, especially when we get into the fall, and those phone lines light
up.
They sometimes are just trying to play stump the Game and Fish guy obscure questions.
Sure. You do a great job answering them.
We won't try to stump you today.
Good.
One of the reasons we wanted to bring David in is to talk about fishing, because David, you grew up as an avid angler in Panama City, Florida, and then came to Arkansas, played college football for the Razorbacks, and really haven't done much of it. But just here recently, you have started fishing again.
You know, it's crazy. My dad was not an outdoorsman. He would hunt. I had an uncle, a great uncle, who was a big time quail hunter, and he also would fish, and I would go with him occasionally. So I think I just, you know, I had access to water. My grandmother had a pond behind her house, and I go out and catch brim. Every weekend I go to her house, and then I moved to an area where I had a lot of access to saltwater canals that would feed in from the bays, and I would go out and catch speckled trout, and I do it every weekend. It was my focus. I mean, I didn't care about girls. I cared about fishing and sports. As a matter of fact, on my walls.
I was going to ask you about the posters.
And this is true, Austin. Trey's heard this, is that I didn't have Farrah Fawcett, which is before your time, but Farrah Fawcett, I didn't have any of those. I had pictures of all the different rod and reels that I had and their gear ratio. I memorized gear ratios of rod and reels and different fish. I mean, that was what my life was about, sports and fishing, and a little bit of hunting too. But and then got to Arkansas and just got so busy. I regret so much that I did not keep my rod and reels. I don't know what happened to them. My mother probably gave them away. And just recently I decided, hey, I'm gonna try to see if I can get the fever back, and did a little fishing, bought some new equipment, and now I got to, again, find the time to do it.
I think that's finding the time is probably one of the things that probably one of the biggest excuses we hear from people of why they don't fish. You got to make time, David.
Yeah, you do.
Well, and one of the things that I think I said last time I was on the radio betraying them was that I am unashamedly a jug fisherman. Sure. I like to cast and retrieve, but jug fishing is the only way that I can catch fish while I sleep.
Gotcha.
There's no passive fishing methods.
That's right.
Well, listen, again, it's something that I love doing. I was trying to think, I don't even really recall, you know, maybe my first time. I just know that it was so much fun, and I've missed it. And it was fun when I went to the night fishing tournament out at Lake Maumelle. Didn't catch a lot, but I'll tell you, just to be out on the lake, beautiful lake, and sun setting, it was just nice, and it made me appreciate, you know, having that opportunity to do it with a goal of doing more of it.
So one of the challenges that we face at Game and Fish, and every state natural resource agency across the country is facing this and has been for a number of years, is, you know, participation. It's been declining over the past couple of decades as, you know, technology is more pervasive, urbanization of society in general, and we're pretty fortunate in Arkansas because we're still a largely rural state that we maybe haven't seen the declines that some others have. But we call this this effort to get people involved and engaged as R3, and that stands for recruitment, retention, and reactivation. Now, recruitment, of course, is pretty obvious. We want to bring new people in. Retention is keeping the ones that we have, but kind of the one that I think we probably, hate to say it, maybe pay the least attention to is the reactivation. And that's what you are. You would qualify as a reactivated angler, somebody who did this for a long time and then fell out for whatever reason and then has come back to it. So what was it about this moment in time in particular that made you say, hey, I want to do this again?
Well, you know, I'd heard about these night fishing tournaments. I've fished in some day tournaments before, just, you know, once or twice over the last 15 years. And so the night thing, the key to me is finding somebody who can help you reconnect easier. Getting me connected with the people out there, you know, going down to a place where I could buy the equipment that I needed. I think that's another thing too, is instruction to where, how can I get back into this? Where do I need to go to make it easy? Because I think that's the key. You're juggling schedules. You're juggling all these things, money, whatever. What are the easiest ways to get you back? And for me, it was just hearing about that night fishing tournament. It's near me. It's not far from me. I know people that are going to be in it. So I think it just all those things added together to say, okay, I'm going to go ahead and do it. It sounds attractive. It's doable. So the more I think you hear of doable opportunities, whether it be grabbing somebody and say, hey, you're going to go with me. I think that's the biggest thing is promoting the people who fish now, take the kid out and do something, or take your buddy out who hadn't been in a while, and it makes it fun. And it was a lot of fun us promoting the fact that I was going to be in the fishing tournament.
Yeah, and you fish with Jack Whitbeck, yeah. Who's brother of Deke Whitbeck,
yeah.
Who is the president of the Arkansas Game and Fish Foundation. And I think we hear that pretty consistently. But, you know, Austin, the agency is doing a lot of things to try to make these opportunities more accessible. Whether that's education programs at nature centers or bank fishing opportunities. You want to address some of those things that we're doing?
Well, and first, I wanted to point something out that's a little bit unusual for our guest here, is that he went from a state where he had lapsed from fishing into tournament fishing. Which, normally, when we talk about...
He skipped a few steps, huh?
Yeah. I mean, normally when we talk about avidity... You know, just how big a boy are you? Just how avid of an angler you are. We normally see bank angling on one end of the spectrum and then tournament fishing on the opposite. So you went from having hung your rods and your reels up all the way back into tournament fishing, which is awesome. But for other people out there that may not take that big of a leap, maybe if they want to get introduced to it, it'd be good to fish in a tournament for the first time, if they can find somebody that will take them and also has the patience for it. But we have all kinds of opportunities throughout the state where if they're trying to pick those rods and reels back up or learn it for the first time, then we can kind of come alongside them and help them do it. I would say the first place to start, which is outside the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, is your local vendor. I mean, just like fishing stuff, just like Southern Reel. We love those guys, and it's not only their livelihoods, but they're also pillars in their communities,
sure.
in their own ways. Kind of inside the agency, our family community fishing program. We have fishing derbies and
which are great.
Yeah, they're outstanding.
Those are tremendous. Yeah,
we have those events. We stock ponds all throughout the state. Just trying to get people out, so you can stay tuned on our website for opportunities to do that. We also have our own outdoor skills program that teaches folks not just how to fish, but how to hunt, how to blow a duck call, how to shoot a bow, all of that kind of stuff. And then we also have our Becoming an Outdoors Woman program, which focuses on our lady friends out there that are interested in either duck hunting or learn how to fish or anything like that. So there's certainly tons of opportunities with the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission and beyond to try to learn how to fish or to pick those rods and reels back up.
I think something that doesn't matter if you're fishing for the first time or you fished a long time ago like David and then you came back to it or whatever the case may be. I mean, or you're somebody that's always fished. It's about an experience and it's about some feelings you have. So I want to kind of get back to What was it that attracted you to fishing? You said you had the posters of the Abu Garcia reel and stuff.
Garcia Mitchell, Ambassador 5000C. I sure did. Yeah, sure did.
What was it that made you want to get outside? That made you want to get a line in the water? I mean, what attracted you? What was the allure in the first place?
Yeah, I think that I remember. I think probably that where it started was being able to have access to my grandmother's pond, where you could see that bobber. There's just something the dynamic of putting something underwater, and you seeing something that's going to help you realize that some activity is going on, and then the fight, and just to see the cork move. There was just something about that was attractive to me, and so I started getting that, and then all of a sudden to move to an area where I could go out and, I didn't need anybody, nobody had to be there with me. I could do it on my own. I could walk, didn't have to have a car. That's why I go back to, being accessible to find bodies of water. Makes a difference for a kid who may not have access or whatever. That was the big thing to me. And can I tell you, I was sort of self-taught. I mean, I just I love the feel. I love the attraction. I love seeing if I can figure out if there's a fish somewhere. I'm going to see if I can get him, catch him. Just the challenge of it. And then the way it felt, I remember as a kid catching those speckled trout. Man, it was just, it was me versus those trout. There was a competitive part of it, and I didn't care about eating it. I didn't care about that. It was the competition part of it, and just the beauty. I think there's a beauty of fishing. There's just something about seeing that rod tip bend, and you trying to get it to the boat. I think there's a beauty in it, and that's what I had as a kid. That's the way I felt about it as a kid.
What about you, Austin? What attracted you to fishing?
Well, I did it because my dad did it, and.
And I think it's pretty common. I mean, we see that in our surveys that whether you hunt or fish, it's because somebody introduced you to it.
And I loved it as a kid. The reason that I've kept with it as an adult is you just use a completely different portion of your brain than you would do, behind a desk all day or working outside, whatever it is that your livelihood is. But there's just so many variables that you can chase if you want to, water depth, what's on the end of your line, where you're fishing. So just to use that portion of my very small, smooth brain that doesn't get exercised very often, that's what keeps me there. And my phone's normally not ringing from people like Trey Reid.
Well, I'll tell you this. I know this is a really sensitive topic on our show. We talk about it all the time, and I've got half the fishermen. You could come to the new school or whatever. Is that part of me is for me is the challenge of trying to catch a fish, and so Austin, I tell Trey all the time, I don't want to have a live scope. I don't want to have the technology where, and I get it, because to me as a kid growing up, it was the challenge of trying to find. Listen, I grew up with an uncle. We went in a flat bottom boat. And he, we either figured out where they were or we didn't. And I sort of like the challenge of that. I like the challenge to go, either I'm smart enough to figure out how, or I don't, or they're smart enough to beat me. And so I've always sort of, even now, if I fish all day, don't catch something, to me, that's part of the game. And I understand now fishing is beyond that. But I think that the competition of seeing, can I outsmart that fish? Can I figure out all these variables to win?
It's like putting a puzzle together.
Yeah,
it's
sure.
Like what,
sure.
Which piece goes where to give me this picture. I think another thing for me at least, and this may kind of sound a little hokey and corny, but I think the reason a lot of people participate, whether it's hunting, fishing, whatever, it's that connection, the connection it gives us to nature. Sure. And it is a literal connection when you have that fish on the line. There is a wild animal that you didn't know. Maybe you saw it. I mean, if you're in a trout stream, clear water, smallmouth, whatever. But like when that fish bites and you are connected by a very thin piece of monofilament or fluorocarbon to this wild animal and you feel its energy, it's pretty remarkable, I think.
Well, and what fishing gives people an opportunity that I don't think there's an analog to on the hunting side is that you can catch some monster fish in Arkansas just by sitting on the side of the bank. You can skip the boat, the live scope, you can skip a lot of that stuff and maybe not have as good of a chance, but still have a good day fishing, just fishing from the bank. And that's one of the reasons why, you probably fell in love with it when you were a kid bass. And also why we're trying to put much more emphasis towards creating bank fishing access throughout the state.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up because that's the next thing for me. So I live over by the Big Dam Bridge.
Yeah.
And so I've driven by there, and the kid in me goes, man, I wonder if I can catch anything. You know, not by the dam, back away from the dam where I could take my rod and reels and walk, you know, and do that, because I do think there's something about that. I was terrible at the tournament, fishing out in the middle, you know, because, you know, Jack could be right over and say, hey, the fish are over there. And I was like, listen, let's go to the bank. Let me fish. Give me something to fish off of, you know. So that was something.
You need a target. Not just throwing out what looks like open water.
And that was, I don't know what that was, but that's part of it too. Is the actual throwing of the lure is hitting a particular spot. I mean, there's all those key things to, you know, being successful.
I sense you brought up the word competition. I mean, we know your history, you know, as a Razorback linebacker, and you said you grew up participating in a number of sports. But it's interesting because, like Austin noted, you went straight from like kind of being out of it for a long time. We went trout fishing a few years ago.
But recently, you went
straight to the tournament scene, the Lake Maumelle Tuesday night tournament. But I sense that the competition for you is less about like competing against other anglers.
That's right. Competing against
the fish.
That's right.
Or competing against yourself.
Right. I mean, yeah, that's the way it is. You're right. Yep. And that's why I go back to without the equipment, it is you. Have you done your research? You know, are you choosing the right lure? Have you cast in the right place? And if you come up zeros, then obviously you got beat that day. And I think another thing that's really attractive to me too as a kid, I always wanted to catch big fish. So down in Florida, you know, you had those big old bass. I remember growing up, we had 2 16-pound bass taken out of one lake in one summer. And, of course, you didn't have as many people fishing. And so that's one of the things up here I always like to try. That's another thing that's inviting to me. I want to catch the biggest whatever, striper or bass. I mean, I want to catch something big, because that's what I grew up in Florida sort of seeing a lot of.
A lot of big fish in Florida.
A lot of big fish.
Long growing
season
down there.
Not that trout aren't great. The little trout that we did, I love those. But I do. There's something to feeling awesome. Wow. I'll never forget you. You know what a gaffsell catfish is.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll never forget being with my uncle out on the river, Choctahatchee River, I think. And, you know, I was getting a little pop on and set the hook and, whoa, it about broke my wrist. And it took me about 30 minutes to get that fish against the current up. And when the gaffsell catfish came up, it had a big, you know, what do you call it?
A big dorsal.
Dorsal fin. Scared me. You know, I was probably 8 years old. I was like, Uncle Joe, what is this? Is this a shark? But again, it's the unknown. Are you going to be able to catch something you've never seen before? How big is it going to be? What's it going to be? Those all make the experience fun.
Mystery.
Yeah,
mystery,
sure.
Mystery is a big deal in fishing, I think.
Yeah.
Talking about big fish, we still have, you know, we caught some little trout that day.
Yeah,
we got big trout.
Well, I know they're big trout.
Had the world record for 25 years on brown
trout. And I'm game. I've never had the opportunity to fish, and I would love, even if I don't catch them, I know I have the opportunity to maybe catch them.
Now, a number of years ago, Wild Man took you on a Mississippi River catfishing trip, but y'all, no good.
It's the typical Bazzel luck, just like with anything I do. Austin, we go out there and been here. Oh, you're gonna catch the biggest catfish, you know. And we fished for like 6 hours and didn't catch anything. And then finally at the end, I think we caught two. It was just, you know, yeah, we did do that.
It was like in July or August.
It is. I tell you, whether it's cursing the Razorbacks in the Omaha and World Series or whatever, it seems like every time I try to do something, it sort of fails. But yes, I do remember doing that with the Wild Man.
What's the biggest fish you've ever caught?
I think I caught some stripers a few years ago. I had a guide, you know, that's another thing. I wanted to catch a giant striper. So again, what happens, I throw this out on the radio and whoever gets me it feels the pressure immediately. Cause all of a sudden the Bazzel Jinx comes along and he's sitting on that boat and I can see him starting to get nervous. And I'm like, man, I don't believe this. We're not catching anything. And I probably caught a 10, 15 pound stripe or something like that. But most of them are, I think the biggest bass I've caught is a 5 or 6 and some speckled trout in the 2 to 3 range, something like that.
Austin, you like to jug fish. What's the biggest fish you pulled up on one of those jugs? Because that's a whole different ball game when you're.
It is.
There's no winch like a reel to help bring it in. It's right. All just pulling it in.
Well, I kid around a lot about jug fishing. The reason I like it is because I got small kids, and I mean, if I had to pick on how I would like to spend a day fishing, it'd probably be black bass fishing, right? But small kids, they like it because it's segmented. They can, you know, there's one phase where they get in the boat and they ride out to where we put the jugs out. The other phase is they watch dad hang off the front of the boat like an idiot trying to pull jugs out of the water. And then the other segment is that they get to go back. But when I was a younger man, me and my brother were jug fishing on Lake Ouachita, and I bet we caught a 20, 25-pound catfish.
Nice. That's got to be fun.
It's crazy. You know, one thing you haven't asked me about, which I'm sort of surprised about, is that growing up in Florida, you have a lot of different opportunities. But I was never a deep sea guy. Never was interested. Never went one time.
Inshore stuff.
Yeah. I just never. And I get it now. I would like to catch a tarpon one of these days. A tarpon would be a sort of a bucket list goal for me. But I just have no desire going out. An hour out, and I've done it once or twice. I'm just sort of I like action. You're casting, you're not doing that. You're trolling in a boat. Would you do some of that? I know with stripers, but I never was attracted to the deep sea fishing.
Have you ever fished yo-yos?
No, I'm familiar with it, but I have not. No,
it's a good time.
It's that passive fishing is it's a whole different deal. It's just different.
Yeah,
it's just different. Talking about to your point about deep sea fishing last October, I went down with actually a former biologist here at Game and Fish whose family goes down to Venice, Louisiana quite a bit. And I have fished in the marsh, like for redfish a number of times, but I've never really been. And I've been on some of the party boats where you go out and you drop over and catch red snapper and stuff like that. It's all great fun and they're delicious. But we went out way, way out, 25, 30, 35, 40 miles, the blue water. And we caught an incredible fish. We caught a 175-pound yellowfin tuna.
Yeah, very cool.
But when I say we, there were four grown men who took turns to crank this thing in. Dude, it's work.
I know.
I mean, yeah. I'm enjoying the yellowfin tuna still, but I don't know if that's something I want to go do every day.
Yeah.
And maybe if you told me I was going to catch a marlin or a sailfish, something like that. I guess. But another thing, I don't know if you guys have been down to Florida enough. One of the other things that I was exposed to as a kid, I would go to a place called Captain Anderson's in Panama City, which is the premier seafood place right there in the bay in Panama City Beach. And they would have all these ships coming in, all these boats coming in with tons of snapper. And they would take out, 50 people a day, and they'd come back in and see that. So that was also a very popular thing to do. Again, not attracted to me. I want to be working. I want to,
You want to chunk and wine.
I do. Yeah, that's more attractive to me.
Speaking of things you want to do, what's on your Arkansas fishing bucket list? You've done the bass tournament. You've done some trout fishing on the Little Red. You mentioned striper fishing. What are some other things you want
to? One of my goals is to go down by the big dam to try. This is my neighborhood dam now. If you will, I want to go down there and figure out where I feel comfortable, what I can do. I see some go out there with heavy tackle and big tackle. I don't know if I want to do that or not. Again, I think I want it manageable, easy to move around. I'd like to go after some more trout. Being on the Little Red,
that struck a chord with you.
Austin, that was my first time, and I was like, if I could come back, I would do more of that. I would love to have a place there. Beautiful, clear. Now, we had some of those clear springs we had clear springs in Florida. So that's what it sort of reminded me of. Cool, beautiful, love that. But maybe catching the opportunity to catch some bigger trout would be fun too.
So when you went trout fishing, and on our first podcast here, I don't want to just blow off a powder keg, but were you fly casting or spin casting?
No, it was fly casting, but I don't know how you remember it was fly casting.
Spin cast. With the trout magnet. We were actually with Jeff Smith, the founder of Trout Magnet.
My last time I did go fly fishing somewhere. I think I was in Wyoming. I'm sorry.
That's right. Y'all did the big guys trip.
I did fly fishing up there, but that one, you're right, was different. Obviously, you would say fly casting would be the most fun. Yeah.
You're saying you don't want to blow up a powder keg here, but you're immediately jumping to this dichotomous thing between fly fishing and conventional tackle.
That's right.
I haven't done much. I've done fly fishing one time. It was in Wyoming, and that was outside of Yellowstone. And it was cool. I enjoyed it. It was something different. But you're saying you're not a big fan of fly fishing versus the other?
I'm saying I as the director, I represent all. Of
well, I don't listen. I know Clay Henry, the son of Lake Orville Henry, is a huge fly fishing
Clay's a big
fan. And people
he's working at a fly shop up in Norfolk.
People
now.
Love that. Yeah, it's I haven't been around that world very much, but I can get the passion for it.
Yeah, it's. I think the joke there is that there's no way to start an argument about fishing is better than to talk about fly fishing versus spin fishing or conventional tackle. I do them both. Too. Like Austin, as a representative of the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, we're just all about fishing.
I will say this too. One of the things that changed from my childhood to now is that, I can remember, I've seen pictures of my uncle. He would have, 15 bass and they would all be like 5 pounds plus. I mean, it'd be huge. And the catch and release, program that's gone on for 20 years now, 25 years. I love that. I just think of how. If it's been that long, it might not have been that long.
Longer than that. Maybe it's been, the early 70s is when it.
When I was fishing, you didn't have that. Yeah. That was not.
The ethic is like a lot stronger.
Yeah, I love the fact that it allows people to maybe catch more fish, and I love that part of it. We didn't have that back in the day. And again, we were aluminum bottom boats, catching as much fish as you wanted to in a day, and then eating them that night for the most part.
Well, we've actually kind of come full circle on that now, and. We don't want to discourage catch and release, certainly, but there are some bodies of water where we wouldn't mind if people kept a few more fish.
That's right.
Yeah, well, I love that. And then the other thing we had mentioned that I had not, Austin, I had not tried crappie before. I had really not eaten, and you guys cooked us some for the morning, and it was wow. I was blown away how good that was. So that's another fish that I have not really gone out and caught. That I would, I'd like to do sometime.
Well, I'm hearing I think we're going to have a long list of fishing opportunities that we need to get you lined up with.
Yes, yes.
And to the point, like you said, accessibility is a big part of that.
Easier you make it for people, I think the better, for whatever, whether it be the equipment, location, whatever, the better chance you have of succeeding, yeah.
So, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
You're an athlete. You like action when you fish,
right?
You've said that. Would you like to go noodling?
Somebody's asked me about that. It's my summer of adventure, Austin.
Let's see how long it takes him to talk around.
It's my summer, so I jumped out of an airplane at 10,000 feet.
Well, if you can do that, so that's what I'm saying.
So the point of it is,
I
would be game to do that. Now, what I've seen some examples of that where you're really going down to where. I think there would be, it had to be, I'd be open to it. It just depends. I don't want to go down too, I'd probably freak out if I went down too deep to have to do it. But it's intriguing to me. Have you done it?
No.
Yeah,
me either.
I would be game.
All right, let's do it.
All right, I'd be game.
All right.
I think we have an appointment, and we will come back and talk about that on a future podcast.
So I will add this to my summer of adventure. That's even though we may not do it during the summertime. Yeah, gators, catfish, hogs, deer, whatever. Let's do it.
I am really excited to see your excitement. For those that don't know, I've been coming on the morning show for about 6 or 7 years now. And the first, in those early days, you weren't doing a lot of fishing.
No,
you had some background in it, but there's not, I kind of felt like it was a little difficult to talk about hunting and fishing with it's called Morning Mayhem for a reason.
Right. Yeah,
like we're
right,
all, and it's
right.
a sports. It's sports talk radio.
Yeah. Well, we also do. We have so many. As Austin, as Trey said, we've got tens of thousands of guys who listen every day that are avid, not only avid fishermen, avid duck hunters. I mean, it's you name it. Deer hunters.
It has been very enjoyable to see you getting back to it.
Sure,
the excitement and because I think. And Austin, jump in here whenever, but everybody looks at the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission as, we make the rules and we manage the habitats. And yes, we do all that, but ultimately, man, we're selling a lifestyle.
Yeah,
and
that's right.
And a fun experience.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and again, that's why we want to support you guys because again, Arkansas, I'm really proud. I talk about being from Florida, which has amazing outdoor availabilities, but you know, I'm proud to be here in this state. You know, this is my home state now, and, you know, we have beautiful outdoor opportunities and, I mean, gorgeous. You mentioned, like, Washita, all the great lakes and hunting, and I love the fact that, you know, I love being able to tell people we're the duck hunting capital of the world, which we are. So there's so many things to do here, and I have become more engaged. And, of course, the other thing, I'm almost 60. You know, I'm you know, a year away from 60. So I think realize, too, you know, life's short. Let's go back and do some of the things we used to enjoy doing that we've been too busy to do, you know?
Yeah, well, that's a great way to kind of put a bow on it, David Bazzel. Man, what a great time talking to you today
about
fishing in Arkansas, and look forward to seeing you every Wednesday morning and talking about the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, 6:30 to 7 usually on Morning Mayhem, 103.7 The Buzz out of Little Rock, and you can 103.7thebuzz.com. You can listen live if you're outside of the area. And we've been talking about podcasting for since shortly after Austin joined us, July 1.
Well, that's great. That's awesome.
21, so it's good to we're getting some of them going now.
Well, I'm honored to be here. Appreciate it. Appreciate the chance to talk. And obviously, we want to be a big supporter too. Obviously, to continue to do what we can do to help support you guys.
Well, thank you. It's great that your support is when people see David Bazzel, a well-known Arkansan, get excited about the great outdoors, that makes other people get excited about the great outdoors. And so we appreciate you too, man. All right, Bazzel, thank you so much,
you
man.
Bet. Austin, thanks a lot. Thanks, Austin. Yep.